its simplest form, the one phase of foreordination means ascribing to God the ability and sagacity to provide with infinite precision the things which form the ongoing of the universe he has created. That the theme extends into realms of other worlds and contemplates that in God which his creatures may not now understand is readily conceded. There is probably little difficulty in the mind of any serious person who holds God in due respect over the issue of his right and accompanying necessity to plan the course of his universe before he brings it into being. Difficulty may arise with respect to the evil that is present now in that which a holy God designed, created, and is executed. Pious souls, however, will not allow that evil is engendered by God, and a reasonable person will not claim that evil is present because God could not prevent it. Nor will thoughtful, observant individuals conclude that the universe is a gigantic accident moving ungoverned to its own destruction. It must be recognized that in some way, quite beyond man's comprehension, the permission and presence of evil in God's universe is consistent with his holy character and cannot be linked with him as in any wise responsible for it. Any ideas or thoughts on that right there? Because the next couple of sentences form a different thought that I want to look at a little more closely. But up until that point, when he talks about, any serious person, any thinking individual, anybody with a brain is not going to do this and this, because he doesn't say it quite like that, but that's what he's basically saying. God is going to have a blueprinted plan of his universe. It's not just going to be some random events that take place, that he's going to know exactly what this is. And it goes back to that phrase I mentioned in the very, very beginning of Augustine, ever changing, yet never changing. He's always changing, but it's not in reaction to the will of man. It's not in reaction to man. There are things that God allows. We refer to that as his permissive will. And then there's things that God does not allow. And we refer to that as his direct will. And there are things in every one of our lives individually that God permitted. And that, in a sense, is a change. It's a change. But the plan of God has never altered, not one bit. And it never will. Had I stayed in school and graduated and gone to college, would that have altered the course of things? Yes, it would have altered the course of things. That I quit high school and hitchhiked around the country a couple of times, did that? Yes, that altered the course of things. But God in his permissive will, allowed and directed. While I was doing what I was doing, there were things that God directly had his hand over me. I can look back on these things now and see very clearly. God and what he did and how he did it at the time. I didn't recognize, see that. No one does when they're in those periods. But shortly thereafter, you were able to see and understand what those are. While you were out, I revealed the mystery. And no one's allowed to tell you what it is. But it was big. It was really big.
It's one of those great ones. Yeah.
So I'm sorry. But any thinking individual would understand that anybody that would begin a project is not just going to. We looked at it. Do you think that the Lord Jesus himself would use an illustration like he gave us in Luke about every man that builds a house sits down and counts the cost? You think God didn't count the cost? You think he didn't?
on Sunday nights, we'll have already done a slow, thorough read of Ephesians 1, because we already went through that chapter about a year and a half ago. But to do that, just the first section of chapter 1 is mind-blowing. There's at least, depending on how you count, 14 things that have just been graciously just, we just poured on. What's been given simply as a deposit. We have a deposit. What men prior to Acts 2 would have prayed for, I'm sure, constantly. David even said, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. You know, in times of crisis in his life, and we have the Spirit indwelling in us simply as a deposit of what is to come. And so it's you'll never get beyond it. We move beyond it in church, you're never going to get beyond the ideas that are there. Nor will you get beyond this next couple's sentences here. When I read this, the first time I read it to my kids was probably 20 years ago. That's what I'm going to say, about 20 years ago. And as soon as I finished, before ordination, I sent them off to do science and math in the old school. I said, go get out of here, go do your work. And I took my volume and I went downstairs to a small in basement wood stove that we had. And I read this, what I'm about to read, over and over again. I could not talk about wrapping your arms and your mind around something. I just couldn't get around it. And it was the first time this idea, this thought had ever come into my presence, and I could not get beyond it for the longest time. Not that I couldn't understand it. And no one will ever understand it in its entirety. I understood what was being said. I just couldn't believe what I was reading. I just couldn't believe what I was confronted with. Listen to what this says. This principle is to be seen operating in another and more attractive form when it is observed that though all few fruitful service is being wrought by the enabling power of the Holy Spirit, number one, God does not withhold or claim for himself any reward for that service when the believer stands before him, the judgment seat of Christ. The Christian is then rewarded as though he had, by himself, achieved all that may have been done in the overcoming and overwhelming and unbelievable power of the Spirit. I just could not get over that. I'd never come across that thought. And it's like, you know what, this is just too much. We're down here complaining and struggling and tripping over our little work that he's given us to do. And then we finally accomplish, we don't even know what, oftentimes not caring about what we're working on. All of these things. And then we go on to be with him. We will receive rewards. After he has saved me, after he has given me his Spirit to indwell within me, after that Spirit opened my eyes to the calling that he wanted me to follow, gave me the tools, gave me the desire, gave me the ability, gave me all of these things, and there I tripped all along the way, and at the end, they're going to stand back and allow me to receive a reward. That's just, that I can't get my mind. That is just unbelievably unfair. It's so beautiful. You know, I mean, it really is. We don't deserve any of these things. No trophies, no crowns. We sing about them. We talk about them. There's everything that we might possibly receive was there because of the grace of God from beginning to end. Not one ounce of it is there because of anything that we have achieved. And yet we are going to receive crowns, rewards, in whatever form or shape those are in, as though we accomplished. Any thoughts? Yes.
And you think of the thief on the cross that just at the very last moment accepted Christ.
Yeah.
Didn't go through this whole process.
No, he didn't. But was this warmly received and taken home as the Apostle Paul was out? Brought him home. You are mine. You are mine. Yeah.
there's an it's more detailed. It's more detailed, and it's in what's written there. You know, I mean, there's and I even get confused at this time, but it's the day of Christ. Judgment of the wicked dead at the very end.
are other passages, but you can begin there and kind of work your way.
Yeah. Any other thoughts on those couple sentences there that we brushed out?
The doctrine of foreordination, then, is almost identical with that of predestination. The former term doubtless has a wider significance in that it may include all things within the scope of God's purpose, while the latter is usually employed only of people and restricted to the predetermined destiny of those who are saved, with the exception of Acts 4:27 and 28, which is a reference to that determined
respecting the sufferings of Christ.
And then there were passages there. So before